Good morning. Democratizing restorative justice is the title which might create a lot of expectations and aspirations, I can imagine. But nevertheless, let me, do an effort and an exercise together with you this morning to see how far we can go in our thinking about making restorative justice practices more democratic. And we will reflect during the coming minutes, during the coming hour even, about the role, of course, of restorative justice in society. So there's a double movement that I will make. I will have a look at how can we include society in restorative justice processes, and how can we include restorative justice into society more generally. And the first part, the first part of my exploration might sound a little bit pessimistic. I will come with many questions and problems, so I apologize for that. But don't run away immediately. Stay in the room, because I believe that the second part is much more positive. It will be much more fun towards the end, I hope so at least, of my presentation. Alternatives to imprisonment is the topic that occupies us all during these days. And I very briefly would like to refer to European regulations at the level of the Council of Europe mainly, also later a little bit at the European Union level, and at the level of the United Nations. And you all are familiar with the European rules of 92 on community sanctions and measures, which were already mentioned yesterday. You might also be familiar with the United Nations Tokyo rules on non-custodial measures, and of course the European probation rules were mentioned yesterday as well. When you have a look at these instruments, often non-binding instruments, but still powerful instruments, I think, there are a couple of things that I would like to focus on. And they all deal or use a balanced approach. It is very remarkable. Even when you just talk about the offender and developing alternative sanctions for the offender, it is always done also with some attention for the victim. And the same applies, by the way, if you look at the recommendations of the Council of Europe about victims, 85, 87, 2006, all these recommendations also try to adopt a very much balanced approach. Give attention to the victim, but also to the offender. Yeah. And another point that is remarkable in all these regulations is the community involvement. They all argue in favor of more community involvement. What that might mean, we will deal with that topic more in depth. Community involvement, for example, that is what is written in some of these documents, by the use of volunteers. Citizens who are doing volunteer work, non-paid work, to work with people who have contact with justice, let's say. So a balanced approach and community involvement. This is important for us, and this will be important also for me when I build up my argument a little bit during the coming hour. To which extent, and that is a question that was already asked several times yesterday, to which extent are these community sanctions and measures, these so-called alternative sanctions, real alternatives to the prison sanction? Well, we must be very realistic, and we know that in most of our countries they are not functioning at all to reduce the prison population rate. There are some exceptions, even in European countries, I know, some countries have been able to apply alternative sanctions in such a way that there is an impact on the prison population. But still, these remain the exceptions. And what we see in our penal practices in most Western societies, North America, Western Europe, is that there's a kind of bifurcation, I would call it. It means that more and more we apply alternative sanctions, If you have a look at the figures in every country, and the figures which you can find back at the Council of Europe all as well, as was mentioned yesterday as well, they are increasing. More community service, more probation measures, more electronic monitoring, more mediation, and all these new types of sanctions. More and more alternative sanctions. And at the same time, when you have a look at the statistics for Europe, you see that more and more prison sanctions are applied as well, or longer sanctions, depending on the situation of the country. So that's this bifurcation. More alternative sanctions, not in order to reduce the prison population, but these two developments go hand in hand, apparently. This is kind of bifurcation. So alternative sanctions are then acceptable and applied for often minor crimes, less serious offenses. But the real criminality is still to be applied with the prison sanction. And this is remarkable. I mean, the use, the increasing use of penalties, sanctions in a general way, alternative or prison sanction, the increasing use of alternative sanctions is remarkable. When you know that crime is not increasing at all in Western societies since the late 1990s, we know on the basis of victim support, victim surveys, but also more recently on the basis of police figures and judicial statistics, that crime in most of our countries is rather stabilizing or decreasing. This is strange. Crime is not increasing at all, it's rather decreasing. We are, as criminologists, now confronted with the crime drop, and we try to understand why crime is decreasing now, last 10, 15 years. But at the same time, we feel the need in our countries to punish more and more. Remarkable. That is an important point for me in order to develop answers, for example, restorative justice answers. When we apply restorative justice models, we should be able to cope with these paradoxical movements and developments. A second point here is, when you look at penal practices and how they are applied in Western countries, is this instrumentalization. More and more punishment, sanctions, prison sanction or alternative sanctions, must serve a goal, must be instrumental in order to reach something, to reach an objective. For example, crime reduction. And also, together with that, we have the tendency that many of the sanctions are applied or have to be applied in a very efficient way. So this managerialism is very important also in the way we apply community sanctions and measures. Now you may say that is normal. Of course, we should apply measures and sanctions in order to reduce crime. I am not so convinced about that. I don't know, honestly speaking, and I charge a little bit here. I don't know whether the justice system is there just to reduce crime. I think a justice system in democratic societies can or should have other functions, or maybe more important functions than crime reduction. If we are interested in reduction or control of crime, then I think there are much stronger methods and models than using the criminal justice system. But okay, we come back to this provocative statement later. Restorative justice. Restorative justice was mentioned so many times yesterday. And sometimes, I must say, it was not so clear for me what the speakers were understanding under the term restorative justice. Well, restorative justice is quite well documented, I must say, in European countries. In Western and Eastern European countries, mediation and other restorative justice practices are well studied. And a last or a more recent proof of that is the book that is published last year by Frieder Dunkel and colleagues from the University of Greifswald in Germany, where they, also on the basis of an action grant, by the way, from the European Commission, as this project, where they have made an inventory, a big study about restorative justice in 36 European countries. So that is so far the most complete and the most recent as well, but certainly also the most complete study, the overview of restorative justice in European countries. And of course, they have also adopted the definition of restorative justice. For example, they have also included community service as a model for restorative justice. But some of the authors who have reported about restorative justice in their countries for that book, yeah, did not agree with that. And they didn't consider community service not necessarily as part of restorative justice. Okay? But anyway, I tried to learn a couple of things from this very broad study by Frieder Dunkel and colleagues. Victim-offender mediation is, we know that, is the most dominant model in European countries. It is provided in 35 of these 36 countries in some degree. Victim-offender mediation. Conferencing, the conferencing model, you might be familiar with family group conferencing. The conferencing model is only applied in 13 countries. You know, this is totally different in the Anglo-Saxon world. There, the focus is much more on conferencing and much less on mediation. Europe, much more mediation than conferencing. There is legislation on restorative justice in almost all European Union member states, 28 member states. So that's remarkable. And it might be that, of course, the role of the framework decision on victims of 2001 has played an important role there. There was Article 10 in the framework decision of 2001 on victims that said that countries, member states, should promote mediation. It was called mediation there. For crimes for which they think mediation is appropriate. But anyway, legislation or restorative justice is present in all European member states, but at the same time, it has a limited role in the overall context of criminal justice systems. When you have a look at the way how the law on mediation or conferencing is set up, is conceived, then you see that the field of application in the legal way of restorative justice is often very much limited. For example, only for crimes for which we should normally not apply a prison sentence of more than 4 years, for example. Yeah? This is the restrictive, limited, selective way as it is defined in many legal frameworks in our European countries, not in all countries. A couple of other lessons are the following. There are 5 countries with victim-offender mediation as a general service. It means they have victim-offender mediation available in the country irrespective of the type of offense, including domestic violence, including sexual violence, and so on. Yeah? Irrespective of the degree of seriousness of the crime, also for the most serious crimes, they apply victim-offender mediation, and also in all the stages of the criminal justice procedure. Now, it is remarkable that these countries that have such a general service available for all types of crimes, in all the stages of the criminal justice process, including the execution of the sentence, that these are countries that all start restorative justice from a victim-oriented perspective, not from an offender-oriented perspective, not from probation, but from a much more victim-oriented perspective. And that is logic, I think, because if you set up and if you think about restorative justice and mediation from the needs of the victim, then there is no reason, unless you can convince me, there's no reason to limit victim-offender mediation to less serious crimes. Because we all know from victimology and from victim support practices that often victims of the most serious crimes have the biggest needs for restorative justice in order to understand what happened and why the offender committed the crime and so. So if we are interested in helping the victims, we should first apply and develop mediation and restorative justice for the more serious crimes. Yeah? Okay? So that is the argument or the idea behind that. Second lesson here is that there are 7 countries in this overview studies that have restorative justice available as a nationwide network with serious caseloads. In many countries, the caseloads, the number of cases that are being dealt with on an annual basis remains limited. We are talking about a couple of thousand cases. It's peanuts when you compare that with the caseload of the court. Yeah? So, but there are several countries where restorative justice is available all over the country, in all cities or all judicial districts, and who have also a serious caseload, where you see that these countries also witness a clear bottom-up development of restorative justice. It all started with small initiatives, local pilot projects, and then they started building the practice in other judicial districts, other regions of the country as well, building up from bottom in a bottom-up way. And then at a certain moment, they adopted national legislation. And this way of development, bottom-up development, might be very fruitful, I think, in many of our countries. Although I know very well, when I say this, that Central and East European countries have witnessed another story, another development. Also, I think under the pressure of the European Union, they have been obliged to come up with alternative sanctions in a very quick way. Yeah? And also with mediation. If you look at countries which were mentioned yesterday as well, Bulgaria, for example, Romania, they also adopted legislation on mediation, but a little bit, I think so, under the pressure as well of the European Union. So much more in a top-down way as well. So there, it is interesting to see to which degree these new practices, such as mediation in these countries, are really supported by civil society, by the community. I hope so, but it's not for sure. So we have seen in other many Western European and also in the Nordic countries that restorative justice has been built up much more bottom up. Restorative justice is politically endorsed now in many countries. In countries as Belgium, United Kingdom, certainly in parts of United Kingdom, Northern Ireland, for example, and so on. It is politically accepted, restorative justice. Also, in Austria, in Czech Republic, and in, even in France now as well, and so on. Politically accepted, legally institutionalized, as I have mentioned, in many countries. But it has, let's be serious, it has a marginal impact. In a quantitative way, also in a qualitative way, I think, in all our countries. I've already mentioned that there's a lot of research and that it is well documented, much better than in the Anglo-Saxon world. We always think that restorative justice was started in Canada or in Australia, New Zealand, and that it came over to Europe. That's not true at all. From the 60s, there were first programs, pilot projects, in Norway, in Britain, in the Netherlands, about conflict resolution, bringing victims and offenders together, and so on. And also, you see now that these practices in countries as Canada and the United States are much more fragmentized, not coordinated at all. And that's a big difference with many European countries, where these things are now much better organized and regulated. I also like to mention the role of the European Forum. I think, in all modesty, we may say that the European Forum has played an important role in bringing people from different countries together so that they can support each other and develop good practices and good implementation strategies. So there are important challenges. A first challenge, when you look at the landscape, I mean, of restorative justice in European countries, a first challenge is the following. Criminal justice agencies are the gatekeepers. This might be normal, of course, and we all accept, I think, that public prosecutors, judges, the police as well, should play an important role in the application of restorative justice, for example, mediation. But you are also often the gatekeepers. It means that they can refer cases to mediation programs, or they can also decide not to refer cases, or to only refer a couple of cases a year, or to refer cases in a very selective way and in a very discriminatory way, maybe on the basis of their personal preferences and so on, not necessarily on the basis of the needs of victims and offenders. So it means that criminal justice agencies can make, but also break, the development of restorative justice in a country. And with due respect to the legal professionals in the room here, but it is true that the criminal justice system is often a bottleneck to apply alternative sanctions and to apply restorative justice. In a critical way, one could say that many of these mediation schemes and programs in our countries have the character of diversion. It means that restorative justice is limited to minor crimes. And it is an alternative for prosecution, diversion. So if it is done in a good way, mediation, then the suspect, the offender, will not be prosecuted. And the case is closed. That is diversion vis-a-vis the criminal justice process. And that's the model, the legal model, that is adopted in most of our countries. But I've already mentioned that there is also a selectivity that plays a role. Maybe a selectivity because of the legal basis, or a selectivity because of the personal opinions of the public prosecutors, for example, in a judicial district, or the lack of time of public prosecutors, or the lack of mental space to have a look also at the victim when they have to deal on a daily basis with a whole pile of files where they have to make decisions. There's also not a right of access to mediation in most of our countries. Not, and also when you look at the directive on victims of 2012 from the European Union, which was mentioned yesterday as well, with the whole list of rights, new rights, fundamental rights for victims. Also when you go through the criminal justice process, you see that there's an article, number 12, on restorative justice in the directive on victims, but it does not talk about victims having a right to have restorative justice or to have a mediator. Victims have a right to victim support, of course. They have a right to a lawyer, to be informed, to be involved in some way in the criminal justice process, but they do not have the right to participate in mediation or other restorative justice processes. Although the directive of 2012 of the European Union is positive about restorative justice, but Article 12 is mainly about safeguards that should be taken into account when people are referred to restorative justice programs. Yeah? That is different from really promoting and stimulating restorative justice as might be in the interest of the victim as well, and certainly not a right of access. Often, also in mediation programs, there is a kind, if you have a look at how they function in practice, mediators often adopt the way of thinking, the concepts and the categories that are present in the criminal justice process as well. Yeah? Because of the selection criteria, for example, to refer cases from the public prosecutor to a mediation service are often on a legal basis, these criteria. They are defined in a legal way. But often this is not a good basis to know what kind of restorative justice must be offered, and so on. So this is a legal approach, not necessarily a needs approach for people involved in these practices. An important criticism on restorative justice is certainly that it is an individualizing approach. Victim-offender mediation is the most clear example of this individualizing approach. Crime is reduced to a conflict between a victim and an offender. Is that correct? Is that true? Who are the stakeholders in crime issues? What about the interests of society, the interests of the state in restorative justice practices? Can we individualize something which is, per definition, not a civil conflict between people, but a criminal offense where there is a societal interest? By definition. Is mediation to be considered, is my question, as a sanction or a measure? It means something that you can impose on an offender. Yeah? Or is it a favor, maybe? You impose it or you propose it to the offender because it is a first offender, to give him a last chance and so on. Is it a favor, maybe? Is it a service? Do you see mediation as a service to victims and offenders, an equal service? You offer a mediator so that victim and offender are able to talk to each other in a decent way. That is a service that you offer to people. Or maybe even a further step is to be seen as a right of access to mediation programs, as I have mentioned already. So it means that mediation and other restorative justice processes can be considered in very different ways. And I think it is so important when we start mediation programs in our countries, pilot projects, that we reflect and discuss with our partners, partner organizations, about what kind of mediation do we have in mind? What is mediation for us? What are the objectives? What is the philosophy, maybe, of mediation? Yeah? And you can think in very different ways about these provisions. I need some water. What about the role of the community and community involvement? So far I have talked about mediation. But of course we have the model of family group conferencing and community conferencing present in some European countries as well. Northern Ireland is the best example of that for juveniles, I think. Yeah. And there you might expect that the community is more involved. Because in conferencing, as compared to victim-offender mediation, the community of care is invited to be part of the mediation, let's say. You do not only invite the victim and the offender to come together and to speak to each other, but you also invite a support person or a few support persons for the offender and for the victim. People who have the confidence and have trust in the eyes of the victim and the offender, they are invited to be part of the process, family group conferencing. It is a way, was often thought, that a way to include the community. But of course, let's be serious. It is just a community of care. Is that the community? Is that society? Of course not. It is a support person for the offender, for the victim. Sometimes it's also a police officer, and so etc. In conferencing present. But still, we should learn from research. And it is so important to have a look in practice what is really going on in the reality. When you apply mediation, when you apply conferencing and other practices. You must study that, you must document that very well. In order to reflect for yourself critically all the time, what are we doing? Are we reaching the community in our practices? What kind of community members are involved in the way we apply mediation or conferencing in our city and so on? And a person who did that for England is Fernanda Fonseca Rosenblatt, who made her PhD and published last year in Oxford, her PhD, about the way how the community is participating in the youth offender panels in England and Wales. Yeah, and that is a model, and it is often said that is a model of restorative justice, is often argued. Yeah, but the idea is anyway to involve community members, and they should then talk with the juvenile and so on. So, a few lessons from this study are the following. Although community panel members, so there's a panel composed each time. Although community panel members play a central role, they do not own the process. They do not determine the direction and the outcome. I quote from the findings, from the conclusions of our study. So they do not determine the direction and the outcome. They are there. Usually two or three community members are invited. It's all organized by a professional, but he or she is inviting a couple of community members. They are there, but they really have not an important voice in the process. In the topics that are being discussed are the outcome. The community dynamics are not involved. The broader community dynamics from that neighborhood, for example, where the crime happened, yeah, this kind of influences from this community are not involved in the way how the youth offender panel is taking place. Panel members do not explore or develop any of the dimensions of the community. Yeah. All the panel members share what was called in study a YOT, youth offender panel, culture. This is also because of the high degree of professionalization of the panel members. So it is a passive concept of community involvement. Where, for example, the agreements that have to be concluded between victim offender with the help of the panel members, community members, these agreements are often written on beforehand, more or less, by the professionals, by the probation workers, let's say. Yeah? So there's not that much room to bring in really new dynamics, new influences, questions, concerns from the community. So it is not really, is the conclusion of this study, it's only one study, it is not really about the involvement of the community. Then we have the model of peacemaking circles. Conference is a model, besides victim offender mediation, but then also peacemaking circles. And there again, you might expect, aha, now we will reach the community. Because peacemaking circles, of course, should not only invite victim offender support persons from victim and offender, but also everyone who feels affected in the community about or by what happened. Everyone is welcome in a circle, in a peacemaking or a sentencing circle. Peacemaking circles, healing circles, sentencing circles. I put them together here under the umbrella of peacemaking circles. So there the wider community is involved, and sometimes also the public prosecutor and the judge is involved in the circle. Then we call it sentencing circles. Yeah. So now we have asked ourselves the question, can we develop such a model that is appropriate for a European legal and cultural context? Because peacemaking circles were first applied for First Nations in Canada and the United States. Yeah. And therefore, another action grant was funded and given to a couple of countries in 2011, 2013. And we tried out in three countries, in Germany, Hungary, and Belgium, models of peacemaking circles, with the help of mediation services. But there as well, it was very difficult to involve and to reach the community. We were not so successful. In the number of cases that we have done, more or less 30 cases in each country, it was not easy to involve the community because we lacked the skills and the methodology in order to reach out to the community. Mediators are very well skilled and they are very good experts in working with a victim and an offender. Yeah? But don't ask them to think from the point of view of the community, because then they stop. Okay? So this study, this pilot project, it was an action research, is now published also in a book a couple of weeks ago. And you can download it, by the way, from that website from the University of Tübingen. Okay. So here as well, in peacemaking circles, it's not so easy to reach the community. That's my preliminary conclusion. Now, I talked already about our experts, for example, the mediators, but also probation officers, victim support workers. They have a strong expertise in understanding the needs, the life world, the subjective life world of victims and offenders and their family members and so on. And that's an important strength. That is something that legal professionals often cannot offer, okay? But do they understand also the life world of the society? Well, I rephrase what I mentioned 1 minute ago. There are no methodological tools available, I think, to involve the wider community in an active way. How to address, I ask myself, how to address and redress social harm? Crime is not only about interpersonal conflict and personal harm or relational harm. That is one element of the harm caused by crime. But there's also the social or the societal harm, and how to address this societal harm, and how to address and redress. And how to empower the community besides the victim offender and their communities of care. Okay. Now there are some important fields of tension when we further start thinking about the community and whether and how we can involve the community better in our restorative justice practices. The role of the community can be conceived in a passive or active way. As is the case with community sanctions and measures in general, we can apply these sanctions and measures in the community, but we can also give the community an active role in working with the offender, working with the victim, and so on. So passive or active, that's one comment. Shall we involve also lay people, volunteers, non-professionals, or are we going in the direction of an ongoing professionalization? is another question. And when you apply to restorative justice and mediation in European countries, you see that there are very different points of view. And countries have adopted very different systems. The Nordic countries, but also partly England and so on, and the Netherlands, Belgium a little bit, have adopted to work with volunteers. The mediators are volunteers. They are paid a little bit maybe for their expenses and so on, but they are volunteers. They are coached, of course, by a professional, by a manager or a coordinator of the local mediation service. That is, I think, the relatively successful model in Norway, Finland, and also other European countries. And that was done in a very, very conscient way. This involvement of volunteers was not only in order to save costs. That was not the most important reason. The most important reason was to involve the community and to capacitate, to empower the community so that they learn again to deal with their own crimes and conflicts. Well, Niels Christie, you know him, a conflict as property was one of people who developed this kind of ideology behind restorative justice. But other countries, you will see in Europe, have adopted a clear model of working only with professional mediators. So it's remarkable. And yeah, and there is often, I think, also a kind of pragmatism behind these choices. Yeah. Whose community we are talking about? When we try to involve the community in restorative justice, should these members of the community represent really the community, the neighborhood, the city, the country? Should that be a representative sample of the community, or is it okay to be selective? And again, if you look at how volunteers are selected in working with probationers or with victims, for example, in our countries, you often see that this is a selected group of volunteers, middle-class people, often people who are teacher, for example, or social worker, and so on. They are often not really representing the community. Yeah? And then we have this, what we can call the punitive turn. When we involve the community, does that necessarily always make our process more democratic, more participatory for victims and offenders? It can also be that the community is very oppressive, very much controlling, very repressive as well, stigmatizing. And again, you know very well, community sanctions and measures can be applied in very different ways. In a very controlling, stigmatizing way, but also in a very emancipatory way and in a very supportive way. Are we talking about the micro or the macro community? Are we talking about interpersonal or the structural level? What to do, I mean here, what to do with social injustices? We all know that offenders involved in crime are often confronted with structural inequalities, with a lack of resources in society, unemployment, for example, poverty, social discrimination, racism, and so on. What to do with these social inequalities and social injustices, which are often, to some degree at least, also the cause of committing crime. If we really go towards a democratic model of restorative justice, we must be able to find a way to include also this structural level in our societies. But that's a big challenge, of course. Yeah. And then community norms are these community norms. I've been talking about the harm to society. There are values, norms that are disturbed by what happened by the crime. This community norms, what is that? Yeah, is that something that can be imposed on citizens, on people? Yeah, throughout restorative justice processes, for example, because you can apply mediation and you can invite also in conferencing, for example, a police officer, which is often done in conferencing, family group conferencing. And the police officer starts with reading the report that the victim made months ago about what happened. In that way, the police has the function to recall the victim and the offender to the social norm. So this is not acceptable because it is against Article 458 of our Penal Code, for example. Yeah? So this is a norm to be then confirmed and imposed. You can go a further step in restorative justice, in mediation processes, and this dialogue that is taking place between victim and offender by clarifying the norm, by explaining the norm. And the police officer and the mediator and the victim and family members who are maybe present in the conference can contribute in an important way in clarifying what is the importance of this common norm or value in our societies, to make that in a very, to clarify that in a very practical and concrete way. And the next step is that you challenge the existing norm, that victim and offender, when talking to each other with the help of a facilitator or a mediator, with the assistance of family members and friends, that the victim and offender, the group, at a certain moment says, yeah, but this norm that is laid down in the law is no longer okay. That is not what is living in our communities. So we should challenge and question the validity of this norm. So that's a very critical point of view. But again, my question is, shouldn't we create kind of processes when we really want to make the thing democratic, I mean? Yeah? Shouldn't we then also include this potential to talk and to reflect in a critical way between victim, offender, and other people from the community about the existing norms? Okay? Okay, community can be considered in very different ways. We have the community of care, we have the local community, we have the wider community, a multiplicity of groups and networks. For example, a Facebook group is also a community. Yeah? And then you have even the community at a global level, a perception of connectedness, an attitude of solidarity. We have all feelings of solidarity at this moment with the refugees from Syria, for example. We are all one community, okay? Many different possible levels of community. Yeah. So these are dimensions of community in a geographical way, the community, the neighborhood, the city, and so on. But community can also be defined through the dimension of relationship and interdependency, and that seems to be very important when we work on crime and when we try to influence people who are committing crime. And then you have also the dimension of identity in the community. A community exists when there's a shared identity in one or another way. So different levels and different dimensions of the community. The community is also important when you look at this figure, which some of you certainly know, people familiar with restorative justice literature. This is the scheme developed by Paul McCault and Ted Wachtel many years ago already, where they have asked themselves the question, how restorative are our practices in restorative justice? Yeah? And they have made a distinction between partly restorative, mostly restorative, and fully restorative. And for example, when you look here at victim services or crime compensation schemes by the state in our countries, they are partly restorative. They redress or repair some of the damages to the victim. But you do not include the other stakeholders or the other parties. Yeah? When you look here, for example, at a community service, it is partly restorative because it is only looking at the offender. Yeah? Here, the same, these are the communities of care that are addressed. Now, you have fully restorative justice programs where the three stakeholders are represented or coming together: victim, offender, and the community of care, or even the broader community. And therefore, peace circles, family group conferencing, community conferencing, are according to them, the most restorative models. And victim-offender mediation is only mostly restorative, because here the community dimension is not included. Yeah? So it has to do also with the degree of restorativeness, this kind of community dimension. How does the offender experience the community? That is important for us as well, I think. Research on the experience of community service in Belgium, for example. We have done a research where we have interviewed people who had gone through a system of community service. Yeah? And we asked them about their experiences with the community service. And then it became clear in that research that the offenders feel responsible to some degree. They all say, yes, I am responsible for what happened, for the crime. But I have not harmed society. That was a strange contradiction, or apparent contradiction. Offenders feel responsible, they accept the punishment. But do, when you ask them, did you harm society? No, that's something that they do not experience. It is important when we adopt the goal of redress or reparation to the community in our community service programs. Because that might be something that is not present in the mentality or the mind of many offenders, this community and community redress or reparation. Are offenders oriented indeed to the community as we hope they should? That's a very important question, I think. When do we bring offenders into contact, by the way, with the community? Take again the example of community service. We bring them into contact with the community when they have to execute, when they have to do their community service, after the decision by the judge. Yeah? But this decision of the judge is often not their decision. I mean the decision of the offenders. So shouldn't we go much more into the direction that we involve the offender in decision-making processes at the level of the judge? That's a risky business, provocative question, I know. But still, shouldn't we, I repeat my invitation, shouldn't we give the offender, also the victim by the way, shouldn't we give them a much more active role, maybe not a decisive role, but a much more active role in deciding about should this thing be punished, and if yes, what kind of sanction should be proposed or imposed in this case? Okay, when we try to involve the community, we can also make the distinction between direct and indirect support. And again, there was a European project years ago by the European Forum on building social support for restorative justice. How do you do that? Building social support in societies for restorative justice. Of course, we have the communities of care, family members and so on, can offer a direct support to restorative justice processes. The support, the assist the victim and or the offender. But there's also support possible at the level of the wider community. So citizens can participate in mediation and restorative justice programs, being volunteers, being a member of the steering committee or the board of a local program. That has an added value as well. And that is a kind of volunteer work as well, of course, and a way to involve the community in our restorative justice programs. We can also think about cooperation with civil society organizations, so that other organizations, social services, schools, neighborhood committees, hospitals, and so on, can refer cases to the mediation program. Maybe we should not expect that all these cases are only coming from the justice system, because I have mentioned already what the problem is there in many countries. Maybe we should broaden these channels to refer cases to mediation and restorative justice programs. We can offer training to these other social services. We can build awareness in these circles. We can give them all kinds of support so that you not only have to refer cases to the mediation program, but that they are within their own organization, become also much more skilled to apply mediation and other ways of dealing with conflict in a participatory and in an inclusive way. That is maybe also restorative justice, to spread restorative justice within existing civil society and other organizations. So it is about bonding in terms of social capital. It's about bonding with other organizations who are working in the same field. But it is also bridging towards other sectors in society who are usually not yet working with crime, or at least not in a very intentional way. Bonding and bridging. Indirect support can be offered at a public level, of course, and we all know that if you really want to apply mediation, we need some degree of public acceptance. Yesterday it was mentioned several times. And people many times argue in that respect. I'm in favor of restorative justice. I'm in favor of restorative justice, but. But the public in Italy, the public in Belgium does not accept it. It's not yet ripe for this kind of things. So we need to build, I think, public acceptance. We should not just sit and wait. Yeah, but you can build public acceptance by developing, for example, communication strategies towards the public, to build cooperation with the media, for example, local media, national media. Yeah, but also to learn, also in learning to work with politicians and with policymakers. Many people working in the field of alternative sanctions and restorative justice do not like that, to talk to politicians, to members of parliament, and to policymakers, because that is not their cup of tea. They are there for the victim and the offender, so to say. But in a program, also in local programs, I think you must have and build also some skills, capacity, expertise in working at the policy level, at the local level, at the regional and at the national level. I think it is important if you really want to apply restorative justice in a broad way, if you really want to democratize restorative justice and to involve our societies in restorative justice. It might be, but I will not do that now, it might be a useful exercise to compare restorative justice with growing notions of community justice, as developed by Adam Crawford from the University of Leeds, for example. And here again, when you compare these items, you see how different our approaches can be. In restorative justice, we start from particular cases. What happens to the victim and the offender? In community justice, when you adopt this kind of conceptual framework, in community justice, you start from a collective experience. What happens to our community? What is wrong with our community? So that's not that much an individualizing approach, but the starting point is the community and what's wrong in the community. And that is exactly also what peacemaking circles, as applied by First Nations in North America, are doing. They do not start from what is wrong with the offender or what are the needs of the victim. No, they start the circle process always by talking and reflecting about us, about our community. What are our shared values? That is always the first phase of going through a peacemaking circle process. And when then they have built sufficient common ground, then they start talking about what happened there. Yeah? So that's a different, fundamentally different point of view and different starting point. So you build up your practice from the point of view of the community, and that is different from just individualizing and starting from the needs of victim and offender. We should also keep in mind, of course, the victim's perspective. Crime is also about not only harm to a person, as I have already mentioned, it is about societal harm, and it's also about a wrong and wrongfulness. What is that? The experience of wrongfulness for victims. It is not just about financial compensation and financial damages, and also, but what is the experience of wrongfulness? And there is good research about that. We should use these insights to build our practice as well. Cathy Daly has done research on the, what she calls the justice needs and the interests. What is justice for victims? What is the experience of justice? I'm not talking about the decision by the judge. That should contribute, of course, let's hope, to the experience of justice. But justice as a psychosocial notion is much broader and much complicated than a legal notion of justice, of course. And she makes the difference between needs at the level of participation, having a voice, validation, vindication, and offender accountability. And it is important in our models, in our practices, that we work at all these levels, I think, when we really want to serve victims and to offer them an experience of justice in mediation, for example. Meeting victims' needs can be done by offering them fair treatment in the justice process, information or participation. Then we talk about interactional justice, informational justice, or procedural justice. So it seems to be that these practices, seen from the victims' needs and the victims' needs of justice and the experience of justice, that there is a kind of interaction, that the restorative justice should be interwoven with criminal justice processes. So I'm moving now towards my argument to say that restorative justice or mediation should not just be an alternative. It's maybe not an alternative sanction at all. It has to do with justice. And it has to do with also the way how the criminal justice system is offering justice. And restorative justice should interfere, should interact, should contribute to the way how the criminal justice system is delivering justice. That is my point here. How to include now justice in restorative justice processes? What happens when mediation is done in more serious crimes in an office of the criminal justice process? That is a situation, mediation for more serious crimes, that is a situation where you cannot, let's be reasonable, where you cannot see mediation as an alternative. For example, rape cases, armed robbery, murder attempt, and murder. Of course, these cases will be dealt with by the judge. I hope so, at least, in most of our countries. Yeah, in all of our countries. So how does mediation, when you do mediation in such cases, how does that relate then to the criminal justice process? Not as an alternative, because you have two parallel systems. You have the criminal investigation and the sentencing, prosecution and sentencing of the offender. And at the same time, you have the mediation process. How do they influence each other? That's very important to study that and to see also what the potential and the limits maybe are of this type of interconnection between restorative justice and criminal justice. And that, again, can be learned very interestingly when you study mediation processes for more serious crimes, as we have tried to do in Belgium, where we do mediation for the most serious crimes as well, even in murder cases. This is not exceptional at all. It is quite not often, but in a very regular way done also between the offender who is in prison and family members, survivors, family survivors of the crime. And there you see, of course, what kind of interaction is growing between this process of talking to each other, victim and offender, even at the pre-sentence phase. And what is the judge then doing with that? Let's say that victim and offender are able to talk to each other with the help of a good mediator, yeah, in a very serious crime. They agree, they make an agreement, maybe on the financial compensation, on the moral compensation maybe. They offer apologies, they have talked about what happened. They have built some level of respect mutually, some level of understanding. They are not friends yet, of course. It's stupid to think that they have to become friends, or that there is reconciliation in all these cases. I certainly do not talk in these terms. But at least they seem to be able, with the help of a good mediator, to build some mutual respect and understanding. Okay, and you write that down in an agreement with the help of the mediator. That agreement is going to the public prosecutor and the judge. What the public prosecutor and the judge have to do with that? And when we interviewed the judges who were taking part in this action research in the 90s in Belgium, when we developed that model of mediation for more serious crimes, when we interviewed these judges, some of them admitted indeed, yeah, but what is my role now? What is punishment? What is the meaning of punishment? If I see that victim and offender in such serious crimes are able to talk to each other, then I must really rethink. I must start rethinking the role of punishment and my role as public prosecutor and judge and the function of public prosecution and the function of sentencing and adjudication in my country, in my daily work. That is what I mean by this kind of possible interaction, challenging as well, from the side of mediation. Yeah. So I think what I explore here, I think you see that, is a kind of new type of dynamics, where there is a kind of interaction, a dialectic between the informal level of doing justice between people and the formal institutional level of doing justice. Can a system be created for continuous bottom-up value clarification where the justice of the people, that are the victim, the offender, other people who talked with each other about what is right, what is wrong in this case, that is the justice experiences of the people, where the justice of the people bubbles up to reshape the justice of the law. That are the way of thinking, the attitudes of the judges and the public prosecutors. So to reshape the justice of the law, and we have the justice of the law by going through this process, by having made the decisions that are necessary, where the justice of the law percolates down to the world of the citizens. This is what Braithwaite and Parker call the informal formal dialectics. And that is restorative justice, not just an alternative, but in an ongoing interaction. It is a process of doing justice in an ongoing interaction with the way how justice is done in the criminal justice system. It is, Braithwaite is saying, a type of deliberative justice. It is about restorative justice. It's about people deliberating over the consequences of crimes and how to deal with them and prevent their recurrence. Thus, restorative justice restores the deliberative control of justice by citizens. I'm coming to an end. What does I learn now about the possibilities of doing restorative justice and justice in a general way, in a more democratic way? 3 points. One, there are important dimensions, crucial dimensions at the process level first, that we have further to develop and to explore. We should always start in this kind of restorative justice processes when we want to make them really democratic or more democratic. We should always start from the life world. That is clear. Not only the individual life world, but also the life world of society. Yeah. We should, of course, always give room to participation, but not just participation in one way, but participation where people can contribute to the deliberation in their case, where they can go in dialogue also with the judge, I mean, okay? Victim and offender, also offender, yeah? Where there's a community involvement in an active way and in a representative way, in some way, yeah? Not that it should be representative for the whole community, but at least for part of the community. And where there should also be an orientation on redress and restoration and peacemaking, of course. We do not give participation, we do not see participation as a way to exclude people. That could also be participation, of course. Yeah? Second point is refers to the conditions at the organizational level of our restorative justice programs. We should organize restorative justice in a neutral way. We should give it a neutral place. We should give it sufficient autonomy. It should not be influenced by the rational of the criminal justice process too much. It should also not be influenced by the rational of therapeutical programs, for example. It should find a place on its own where this kind of exchange on what is justice can develop in an autonomous way, influenced by all these other fields and all these other rationalities. There should be a continuous interplay with the criminal justice system. Yeah? We should also be able to address social inequalities. There is a need for social justice. We should try to link, to bridge our processes to structural solutions. I have not been able to discuss that in depth now, but I have learned a lot from South Africa in this respect, more precisely the Swela Temba model that was applied and developed in the townships in Cape Town, where these structural inequalities, unemployment, lack of housing, were dealt with also as a consequence of restorative justice processes. And finally, it offers this kind of restorative justice in a democratic way, offers perspectives at a broader societal level. I see justice and restorative justice, but also justice not as a risk or something to be afraid of or a threat. We should create an image of justice with the help of restorative justice. We should create an image of restorative justice that is something positive, a positive experience, being able to contribute to justice as an offender, as a victim, as family members is a big opportunity, and it should be presented much more in that positive way, justice and restorative justice. So it can also help to improve the image of justice and the justice system. That way, restorative justice can contribute to a more democratic, a more inclusive, responsive, accountable system of justice. And I think, and that's my last word, that this kind of justice and this kind of restorative justice is corresponding much more with the original notions of criminal justice. What is criminal justice? What should criminal justice be? What should be the final goal of our criminal justice system? It should contribute to restoring social peace in our societies, under the rule of law, controlled by law, of course, but restoring social peace. And I think that is the strength of restorative justice, when you build it in this kind of interactive way, interactional way, between informal justice practices and formal justice practices. I thank you.